Hi everyone. So today we'll start with introduction to computers programs in Java. But before we talk about that, I wanted to tell you about the labs. So the labs are posted in course documents. And you will find already the labs for this week. The labs, as you know, are twice a week. For any one of the lab sections, Monday and Wednesdays, or Tuesdays and Thursdays at different times. So twice a week, you will participate based on your section to a lab. In fact, you don't need to participate in that section. You can participate in any one of the sections, as long as by the end of the week, you submit the labs by Friday end of day. So basically you're at midnight on Friday, 11:59 p.m. on Friday, on Saturday, actually. So you have the whole week and Saturday to finish the labs. The first lab is about installing everything you need this semester and experimenting and debugging with Eclipse. And I basically made a long list of to-do tasks that basically you try different things for this lab. The leading TA is the first TA in the list of TAs that you find on Piazza. So if you remember on Piazza, each lab has one or multiple TAs, usually two, three TAs. In the case of the first lab, basically the first TA is the one that starts. For other labs, basically the first TA solves the first problem, and then the second TA, the second problem, the third TA, the third problem, and so on. For this first lab, you will download JDK 8. The TAs will show you how to do that. Basically, you Google JDK 8. You can download the Sun version or the Oracle version of JDK, or you can also download the OpenJDK. You need to install it based on your operating system. You downloaded the correct version of the JDK. You need to install it and then download Eclipse also for the OS operating system that you have. And you will be asked which version of Eclipse you need to install. You can download the standard standalone for Java development version. There are many different versions of Eclipse. There is one for Java EE, for web development. There are actually even versions of Eclipse for other programming languages like C. And you will learn how to create a project, create a class within that project, and then run and debug that class. There are a few more advanced tasks, and those tasks are about running Java and the compiler and Java, JVM, Java Virtual Machine, for your OS in the shell, in the command line. And this, unfortunately, is different for every operating system. So depending on what machine you have, you can run CMD or PowerShell for Windows, Terminal for macOS, and any other terminal for Linux. In Linux, you have Shell, Bash, and many other terminals. Basics for terminal commands, basically, the TAs will teach you how a file system is organized. Basically, a file system usually starts with the root, like C colon in Windows, or forward slash the root in Linux or Unix-based machines. Then all files are organized in folders. In each location, when you open a terminal, you can actually use paths relative to the current directory, that is called the relative path, or you can use paths, absolute paths, the entire path from the root to the file that you want to open. There are also two types of files. There are text files, like for instance, source code.java files, and binary files. Today we'll talk about binary quite a lot. They are machine level language files. They are basically a sequence of zero and ones. They are binary. Also, there are a bunch of basic commands. LS is for listing the current folder. DIR is the equivalent for Windows. So LS is usually for Unix or Linux-based machines like Mac OS X and Linux, or any kind of versions of Linux. Then you have CD for changing directories, mkdir for making directories, pwd for finding what is the current directory on Linux. On Windows, usually when you open cmd, you have the current directory shown to you, so you know where you are. On Linux, you have a prompt, and if you really want to know where you are, you would run that command, pwd. And then you will have to use Java C and Java to compile your files. I also included a link to a simple tutorial on the Ubuntu website for command line for beginners. It will start with a short history about command line interfaces, and then it dives into these kind of simple commands. Now, I also included actually a terminal that you can run in the browser itself. This is actually a terminal implemented in compiled with WebAssembly into WebAssembly with Emscripten, and it's really a terminal that you can run in the command prompt, so you can actually have one single terminal on which you can run that entire set of commands. So you see, basically, you have the standard commands ls. You can see what is in the current directory. Pwd to see where you are. In this case, I'm in home user. Then you can edit files with pico. So hello world.java. I already wrote it. I wrote a public class hello with the main method that prints hi. I will exit with Control X. And then I can basically compile it with Java C and run it with Java. So having a command prompt in the browser is quite useful because you don't need to run something on your machine which is different based on whatever operating system you have. You can also run these commands on a Chromebook, which doesn't have actually a terminal. It's just a web machine, a machine for browsing the web. So you can play with that. The only thing that you need to submit for this lab one are the two files, hello world and changemaker.java, which you will find in elementary programming. One of the lecture slides has hello world. So this is the Hello World application on slide 31. You can copy it and paste it into a file with the same name and then run it in Eclipse and make sure that it runs. And the other one is the Changemaker. So Changemaker is on slide 32. And again, the idea is that you copy it in Eclipse and you run it to make sure that this whole all of this works. And you are able to submit from now on your lab or your homework on Blackboard. The TAs that actually taught the lab yesterday, they also made a video. So for every lab, for instance, lab one, the first lab of the week or the first lab of the set, because there are two labs in every week, they will be recorded. So in case that you miss the lab, or you want to see the recording later, you can just go to the recording and watch it. Okay. The lectures, as I told you already, they will be posted on YouTube, and they will also be posted. The link from Zoom will be posted, so you can watch it in either place. Okay. So let's return back to our lecture for the day. So today we'll talk about an introduction to computers, programs, and Java. And you can stop me at any time if you have any questions about the class. So we'll start with a computer. So what exactly is a computer? And by a computer, I mean different things. I mean your computer or even your smartphone or your iPad, basically, or even a smartwatch. They are all about the same idea, that you have a central processing unit, main memory, which is volatile memory, the hard drive or any kind of persistent memory, monitor, printers are output devices, input devices like keyboard, mouse, even touch screen, and communication devices like network card, also an output device. Now, this is kind of a simplified view of a computer because computers are very complex these days, and you have not only one CPU, may have one CPU. The network card has its own GPU, and they basically, it's not always true that all of the devices, all of these will sit on a single bus, communication bus, but actually you will have different communication mechanisms between these units. So you have the motherboard will have basically USB ports, or it has network port and so on. So the idea is really that you have multiple components, and we'll talk about each one of these components separately, and I will tell you basically what is important about each one of these components. I see a message in the chat. Okay, good. It's not about the class. Okay, so let's start with the CPU. The CPU is the central processing unit. The idea is that it's basically the microcircuit which retrieves instructions from memory and executes them. So if it's an add, it will do an addition of two registers, do locations of memory, and saves the value in another location of memory. So, and if it's a load, it loads the some data from main memory into the cache, or from the hard drive, hard disk into the main memory, and so on. So all that the CPU does very fast is to retrieve instructions one by one, which are usually in slices of same length in memory, and execute them. The speed of the CPU is measured in hertz, which is cycles per second. So really the idea is that you have a clock that sets the pace that these instructions are executed per second. And it's not quite true that every instruction takes one single pulse. In fact, the idea of modern CPUs is that you have actually different parts of the CPU that do different operations, like one in one pulse per second loads the instruction. Next one in the next pulse of the second, next pulse, it executes the instruction. Next one actually stores the result. But when you average out, you basically kind of get 1 million instructions or some amount of instructions per second. So that's basically the speed of the CPU for executing instructions. Okay. And they are measured in million, usually, because these CPUs are extremely fast, or billion instructions per second. So you have megahertz, usually, that a CPU is rated, it's advertised in, or gigahertz. Now, the CPU takes data from main memory, which is very fast memory that is volatile and sits very close to the CPU. Every level, the memory is organized in hierarchies of speed. So there is the cache, which is actually on the CPU itself. There it's you can load and store values in the cache extremely fast at the same speed with the CPU itself, okay? Then there is memory that sits on the main board, but is not in the CPU itself, is usually an order of magnitude slower, but is much larger memory. So it stores the data, it stores the programming instructions for the CPU to load and execute. And this memory is sliced into slices of basically same size. Now, before we talk about the memory, let me tell you about how is data represented inside a computer. Data is represented in binary. So all data is all numbers inside a computer. And then there are translation schemes from number to characters, or number to anything else that you want to represent, instructions and so on. But computers don't use a decimal. So we humans, we are used to basically count our belongings in decimal, in base 10, because we have 10 fingers. And when ancient humans counted their belongings, they basically counted in decimal. They have 10 objects, or they have 12. So they would show first 10 and then 2 and so on. So basically, they humans work in decimal, and it's natural for us to work in decimal. Computers are built out of transistors. The CPU and everything is basically gates which are either on or off. So a transistor either is on, it transmits current through the gate, or off, it doesn't. So everything is represented inside the computer in binary, zero or one. So as we are using decimal for basically everyday life, computers are using binary for everyday. So the binary number system is basically a number system that has two digits, zero and one. Everything inside the computer is represented as zero ones. And the memory is sliced, is basically grouped into groups of 8 bits. So basically binary digits, bits, a bit is a binary digit. So basically you will have slices of 8 bits. Like for instance, this one here, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0. If 8 bits, 8 values of 0 and 1s. Now, these are representing in fact data. So first of all, you can take this binary value and transform it into base 10, because you basically all of the, you can choose any number system and represent the number in base 10. And then there are translation schemes and codings. Like for instance, this number here actually represents the uppercase J character. And this one here represents the lowercase A character and so on. So basically first thing that I want to talk about today is binary representation of numbers. And then we'll talk about encodings. How do you actually represent characters in binary? So as I basically told you already, computers use binary. And the reason for that is that they are built out of transistors, which are either on or off. So they represent zero or one. And it's much cheaper to build computers that basically internally work in binary numbers. They are not visible to us because basically we are using interfaces that we enter decimal numbers in the computer. But internally, the computer basically translates the decimal into binary, and everything is stored or processed into binary. It's much more efficient, both building computers that are represented in binary is space efficient, and the cost is much more efficient. In the 80s, people will try to build computers that were in different bases, but they were much more expensive, sometimes two orders of magnitude. So when people basically offer you something that is 100 times more expensive, you don't take it. So that's basically why we are now used to computers that are in binary. So let me, before I get into binary, let me explain to you what is a number system. And basically we'll start with the decimal number system. So the decimal number system is what we are using currently. And we have 10 digits to represent decimal numbers. These digits are the characters from 0 to 9. A decimal number is a sequence of one or more of these digits. So for instance, 7,423 is a decimal number. It's a sequence of digits out of this set. The value of each digit in the sequence represents basically that number in that position. So when we have 7,423, we know that this 7 here is multiplied with 10 to the power 3 because basically it represents 7,000. This 4 represents 400. It's 4 multiplied with 10 to the power 2. 2 represents 20 in 7,423. Again, it's because it's 2 multiplied with 10 to the power 1. And 3 represents 3 because it's basically 3 multiplied with 10 to the power 0. So really, when we are given a decimal number, we start counting from the right-hand side digit with index 0, and then we move on to the left-hand side by incrementing with 1 at every step. And then whatever the number is, like in this case, this 7,423, is actually the digit multiplied with 10, which is the base or the radix, to the power of the position. So in this case is 7 multiplied with 10 to the power 3 plus 4 multiplied with 10 to the power 2 plus 2 multiplied with 10 to the power 1 plus 3 multiplied with 10 to the power 0. That's why we are getting 7,423. Okay. So we say that 10 is the base or the radix, and the same idea applies to any other number system. So the same idea that we have for number systems, like 7,423, applies when you have a binary number. 1010 in binary is actually, first of all, what we are doing, we index every number starting from the right-hand side. And then this number is in fact one, the digit that we have here, multiply with 2 to the power 3. Then we have plus 0 multiply with 2 to the power 2. Plus 1 again for this one, multiplied with 2 to the power 1 plus 0 multiplied with 2 to the power 0. So really, we started from the right-hand side. We multiplied this digit with 2 to the power 0. Then we multiply the second digit from the right-hand side with 2 to the power 1, and so on. And now this is equal with 2 to the power 3 multiplied with 1 is 8, plus 0, plus 2, plus 0, which is equal with 10. So in fact, 1010 in binary is the decimal number 10. Okay. So this is what binary numbers do. Basically, computers use binary internally to store data, to do any mathematical operation like addition, multiplication, division. It's all done in binary. And every number internally is basically a sequence of these kind of bits, zero and ones. Okay. Binary numbers are not intuitive to us because we use decimal in our daily life, but the same principle applies. You have a sequence of digits and you multiply the digit for every position with the base to the power of that position. And beside binary and decimal, there are many other number systems. There is hexadecimal, octal, and so on. And you can see that hexadecimal are basically base 16, and it has 16 digits. From 0 to 9, they represent the numbers from 0 to 9. And then because they wanted one single character to represent 10, one single character to represent 11, and so on, they use letters. So A represents 10, B 11, C 12, and so on up to F is 15. So you actually you have digits from 0 to 15, and you can basically build a sequence of numbers in hexadecimal. So let me give you an example. 1, A, C, 4. Okay, this is in base hexadecimal or 16, okay? I use an H for hexadecimal. So really the meaning of this, again, is the same idea that you index every one of those digits with a position starting with zero from the right-hand side, and then moving on with incrementing with one at every position. So 1AC4 is in fact one multiplied with 16 to the power 3 plus A is 10, so 10 multiplied with 16 to the power 2 plus C is 12 plus 12 multiplied with 16 to the power 1 plus 4 multiplied with 16 to the power 0, which is 1. So this is basically, you will compute this 16 to the power 3 plus 10 multiplied with 16 to the power 2 plus 12 multiplied with 16 plus 4. And it will basically give you whatever is the value of this hexadecimal number in decimal. But the same idea applies. And similar for octal. So if somebody gives you a number in octal, let's say 4, 1, 0 in octal. Again, the same idea applies, that you count starting from the right hand side those digits, and then you start multiplying the digit. So 4 multiplied with 8 to the power 2 plus 1 multiplied with 8 plus 0 multiplied with 8 to the power 0 is 0, because 0 multiplied with anything is 0. So this is 4 multiplied with 64 plus 8. Okay. I will not do the multiplication. I'm not quite good at it. Okay. Any questions?
Yeah, quick question. For the hexagonal, where did the 16 come from again?
Hexadecimal stands for 16, for base 16. So hexadecimal is base 16.
Got it. Thank you.
Next question that you may have is why are we talking about hexadecimal? Okay.
Yeah.
And I will tell you why. Because when you are given a binary number, you basically, it's hard to remember. So basically, I will say, oops, I don't want to translate this number to decimal. That will take me a long time. But there is one trick about binary numbers. You can actually group 4 at a time, starting from the right-hand side, and each 4 stands for a hexadecimal digit, okay? So in fact, this number that I just put here, I can 1010 maps to A, 0011 is 2 plus 1, which is 3, and 0111 stands for 4 plus 2 plus 1, which is 7. So this is easier to remember. It's basically A37 in hexadecimal. Similar for octal, if I give you the same number and you want to transform it in octal, what is this number in base 8? What you do, you group the digits 3 at a time, starting from the right-hand side. So those 3, this 3, and this 3. So now you translate each group into an octal digit. So 101 is 4 plus 1, 5. 000 is 0. And 110 is 4 plus 2, which is 6. And 111 is 7. So basically, it's a shortcut, a way that you get a shortcut value for that binary number. Okay. And it's used all over programming. So for instance, there is a method in Java that gives you the address of an object. It's the method toString. And the default implementation will give you the address in hexadecimal, because it's much easier to remember A37 than to remember this 10100011011. No? Okay. Another question from Omar is, why do I actually put this parentheses with a subscript of 2? It's just customary. When you write a number without any kind of mention of the base, is in decimal. But when you want to say that this is actually in base 2, or this one 410 is in base 8, you usually put it within parentheses with a subscript. And again, because I'm using Notepad here, I can't put a subscript. So I just use this notation that the base for this number is octal. So it's just a standard way to specify that the number that I'm putting here is in base 2. And this one is in base 16. And again, 16, usually people just use H, because hexadecimal it's a base by itself. It's customary that that's the base 16. So let me show you. Go ahead.
Okay, go ahead.
No, no, go ahead.
Professor, can you also show us how to convert decimal to hexadecimal?
Yes. In fact, we will go over all of these translations one by one. So don't worry about that. I will show you basically each one.
Are you
going
to show everything? Okay, again.
I will show you how to translate from decimal to binary, binary to decimal, binary to hexadecimal, binary to octal, and so on, and decimal to hexadecimal. Okay, so let's start with basically just a summary slide of number systems. There are binary numbers like this one here. Then there are hexadecimal numbers, which is the shortcut notation for binary numbers. For instance, this one here is in hexadecimal AAA. The hexadecimal system has 16 digits from 0 to 15, and we are using letters from A to F for the numbers 10 to 15. The octal system has 8 digits, and also there is a translation from binary to octal, where if you group from the right-hand side the bits, the binary digits, 3 at a time, they correspond to one octal digit. Okay, but again, go ahead.
I have a question. So for the AAA, how do you know that it's A? Is that something you have to memorize?
Basically, I will show you in a few seconds.
Okay.
The idea is that this number 1010 is the binary number corresponding to the integer 10. How did I get that? It's basically if I transform, and I did here, 1010 from base 2 in base 10, it was 10. And 10 corresponded in hexadecimal to A. Because basically,
do you always assume it's two? I'm sorry. Do you always assume it's two?
Which one?
Because you said it's AAA, but there was no subscript to the other slide.
Or decimal.
Sorry,
yeah.
I should have, you are right. I should have put here that this is a binary number. No, I was talking here about binary numbers, so I didn't make explicit that this is about binary numbers. So this is binary. Here I'm talking about hexadecimals. So this is hexadecimal. I will make these changes when I upload the slides again to the website. Okay. Okay, thank you for these corrections. These are always appreciated. Okay, so now let's transform from binary to decimal, learn the algorithm. So given a binary number, bn, bn minus 1, bn minus 2, up to b0, the equivalent decimal value is computed using this formula. Basically, we started counting, you can see that the indices from the right-hand side, this has the index 0, this has the index 1, and so on. This is a binary number. It's a sequence of bits, 0 and 1s. The rightmost one has index 0, and then we increment with 1 moving to the left. So this bn has index n. Now, the equivalent decimal value is the following sum. Bn multiplied with 2 to the power n plus bn minus 1 multiplied with 2 to the power n minus 1 and so on up to last bit b0 multiplied with 2 to the power 0. So really what if I give you a binary number, you can translate it immediately to the decimal value. So 1 0 in binary, for instance, is 1 multiplied with 2 to the power 1 plus 0 multiplied with 2 to the power 0. 0 multiplied with anything is 0, and 1 multiplied with 2 to the power 1 is 2. So actually 1 0 in binary is 2 in decimal. Similarly, 1 0 1 0 in binary is, again, we start from the right-hand side, and we can actually look here right to the right-hand side. 0 multiplied with 2 to the power 0, which is just 0. 1, this one, multiplied with 2 to the power 1. plus 0 multiplied with 2 to the power 2 plus 1 multiplied with 2 to the power 3. So basically we count from the right hand side starting with 0, and we multiply every digit with the base to the power of that position. So in our case, this 1 multiplied with 2 to the power 3 is 8, because 2 to the power 3 is 8. 0 multiplied with 2 to the power 2 is 0. 1 multiplied with 2 is 2, and 0 is 0. So it's 8 plus 2, which is 10. So 1010 from binary is 10 in decimal. And similarly, the last example, I will not go over it. If you have a sequence of bits, you start counting from the right-hand side with starting with 0, and you multiply every bit with 2 to the power of that position. So the first, the rightmost one will be multiplied with 2 to the power 0, which is just 1. So it's just 1. This becomes 1. This becomes 2. This is still 0. This becomes 8, and so on. One thing that you may actually find quite useful is to learn the powers of 2. So start with basically learning every power of 2 up to, I would say, 2 to the power 10. That would be good. So 2 to the power 0 is 1. Any number to the power 0 is 1. 2 to the power 1 is 2. 2 to the power 2 is 4. Always you start, you take the previous 1 and you multiply with 2, because that's basically what power means. 2 to the power 3 is 2 to the power 2 multiplied with 2. So this will be 8. 2 to the power 4 is 16. 2 to the power 5 is 32. 2 to the power 6 is 64. 2 to the power 7 is 128. 2 to the power 8 is 254. 2 to the power 9 is 512. 2 to the power 10.
Isn't it 256? No.
256. So you are completely right. Thank you very much. Very good. So 2 to the power 10 is about 1,000. It's not exactly 1,000, but it's 1,024. So in fact, you can already see now that 2 to the power 20 is about 1 million, because it's really 2 to the power 10 multiplied with 2 to the power 10. And that's basically 1,024 multiplied with 1024. Okay, so it's about 1 million. That's why you can already see if I have 1 megabyte, it actually means about 2 to the power 20 bits. And really what this tells you is that actually if you have about 1 million, you need 20 bits to represent it, because that's the length that you would need to get 2 to the power 20. Okay, because each one of these is actually, for one bit, it tells you if it's that number or let's say the 10th bit is either 1024 or 0, depending on the bit, because the bits are 0 and 1s. Okay. So when you have, for instance, let's take as an example, some longer number. Okay. So this is in binary, and you want to see how much is this in decimal. So now you basically start from the lowest one. This is the easiest, the reverse order. So it's 1 plus, oops, it's 1 plus 2 plus, this will be 0 for 4, this will be 0 for 8, then this is 16. Oops, I'm always writing them in the wrong place. Okay, 16 plus 32. And this is equal with 9, 11, 1, keep 1, 2, 51. Okay, any questions? Good. Okay, so this is how we do conversion from binary to decimal. Next one is the reverse. We are given a number in decimal, like 123. And the question is, What is that number in binary? So the idea is that what we want to is to find for any decimal number D, the corresponding binary number Bn, Bn minus 1 up to B0, such that D is equal with Bn multiplied with 2 to the power n plus Bn minus 1 multiplied with 2 to the power n minus 1 plus Bn minus 2 multiplied with 2 to the power n minus 2 and so on, up to B0 multiplied with 2 to the power 0. And there is an algorithm which actually is related to the Euclidean algorithm, basically about 300 years before our era. And the idea is that you take the digit, you take the decimal number and you divide it by two. You get a quotient and you get a remainder. The remainder will be after division with two, either zero or one. So either the number was odd and then the remainder is one, or the number was even, and then the remainder is zero. You take the quotient and you continue dividing it by two. So let's take 123. 123 divided by two gives you 61 as the quotient and the remainder one. You take 61 and you continue dividing by two. So 61 divided by two gives you the remainder one and the quotient 30. 30 divided by 2 gives you the quotient 15 and the remainder 0. 15 divided by 2 gives you the quotient 7 and the remainder 1. 7 divided by 2 gives you the quotient 3 and the remainder 1. 3 divided by 2 gives you the quotient 1 and the remainder 1. And 1 divided by 2 gives you the quotient 0 and the remainder 1. So you stop the moment that the quotient is 0. And then you read the remainders in the reverse order as you obtain them. So the last one that you got is the first one that you read. So in this case, it will be 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, which is actually the binary number that represents 123, the decimal 123. So for any decimal, you apply this algorithm step by step. And then you read the remainders, you apply it until you get to the quotient zero, and then you read the remainders in reverse order, and that's the binary number that represents that decimal. Go ahead, I just heard someone. Any questions?
Yes, I have a quick question.
Yes.
Yeah, so the numbers that are, I think they're called discriminants, the ones that are under the division sign, the 1, 3, 7, 15, 30, 61 to 123. How are those chosen? Like, I get 123.
No, you start with 123 and you divide it by 2 and you get a quotient and a remainder. So basically 123 is quotient multiplied with 2 plus the remainder. And the remainder is a number in the set 0 and 1.
Thank you.
Welcome. Okay, so let's take a different number and do an exercise. So let's say that we want to convert to binary 26. Okay, so we'll start. Okay, so what is 26? Is 13 multiplied with 2 plus 0. And now we continue. 13 is 6 multiplied with 2 plus 1. Then 6 is 3 multiplied with 2 plus 0. 3, the next quotient, is 1 multiplied with 2 plus 1. Then 1 is 0 multiplied with 2 plus 1. So now 26 from this algorithm is the binary number. And now we read these remainders in opposite order as we obtain them. 1, 1, 0, 1, 0. Now, let's say that we want to test ourselves. Is this correct? I mean, we do the inverse conversion. So what is 11010 in a decimal? Again, the idea is that we start from the right-hand side and we start counting starting with zero. So basically this will be one multiplied with 2 to the power 4 plus 1 multiplied with 2 to the power 3 plus 0 multiplied with 2 to the power.
I bought this shit right here, boom, boom, and I order some.
Okay, if you don't talk, please mute yourself. Plus 1 multiplied with 2 plus 0. And this is equal with 16 plus 8 plus, okay, please mute yourself.
That's my mental body. He's only 21 years old.
Professor, can you mute everyone because they don't hear?
Thank you very much. Okay. Okay. Abdu, can you mute yourself, please? Good. Okay. So it's 16 plus 8 plus 2. And you can see that this is equal with 26. So we checked ourselves. Now, let's see if there are questions in the chat. Okay, where did we get these? These are just counting the digits starting from the right-hand side, starting with zero. So this is zero, this is one, this is two, this is three, this is four. It's just the position starting from the right-hand side. Okay, good. So that's binary to decimal to binary. The same algorithm applies to any other base. So if somebody tells you, I want to translate maybe the same number, 26 in octal, okay? What is it as an octal number, okay? And the same algorithm applies. So we divide by 8, 26 divided by 8 is going to be basically 3 multiplied with 8 plus 2, which is 24 plus 2. Then we continue with 3. 3 is equal with 0 multiplied with 8 plus 3. And this basically tells us that 26 is 32 in base 8. Okay. So the same algorithm applies to any base. And you can again test yourself, is this correct? Is it true that basically 32 in octal is 26 in decimal? You can basically see it's 3 multiplied with 8 plus 2, because it's 3 multiplied with 8 plus 2 multiplied with 8 to the power 0, which is 26. So yes, it's true. And similarly, if somebody is asking you, what is 26 in hexadecimal? So what is 26 in base 16? Same algorithm applies. So 26 is divided by 16, and we get that is 1 multiplied with 16 plus 10, and 1 is 0. Multiplied with 16 plus 1. So 26 in hexadecimal is 1A, because it's 1 followed by the digit, hexadecimal digit that represents the remainder 10. So 1A in hexadecimal is really 16 plus 10, which is 26 in decimal. So this same algorithm that you saw for decimal to binary works for decimal to octal or decimal to hexadecimal. Any questions? Okay. If not, let's continue. So now, next step, hexadecimal to binary. So to convert a hexadecimal number to a binary number, it's very simple. There is a direct mapping. Basically, the hexadecimal, like zero, is the decimal zero, which has the representation in binary zero. Like in a decimal or any other base, if you put zeros to the left of a number, it still represents the same number, no? Like, for instance, if you put in your calculator in front of 123 any number of zeros, is still 123, because any one of these zeros that I have at the beginning is multiplied with base 10 to the power of the position, unless there is something else that is different than zero to the left of these. These are just zeros, no? So that's why, if basically zero is the binary number zero, but I can put many zeros in front of it. So the idea is that if you have a hexadecimal, any number in hexadecimal, you can convert it to the corresponding four digits in binary, four bits in binary. Okay. And this starts with zero in hexadecimal is 000 in binary, but it also ends with the fact that the hexadecimal F is in fact 15 in decimal, because that's just a mapping. Basically, we have digits from zero to F, which corresponds 15. But if you convert 15 into binary, using that algorithm that you saw before, is actually 1111. And I can show you that that's the case. You take 15, you divide it by 2, you get 7 multiplied with 2 plus 1. Then you take 7, divide it by 2, and you get 3 multiplied with 2 plus 1. You take 3, divide it by 2, you get 1 multiplied with 2 plus 1. And you take 1, the previous quotient, and you divide it by 2, and you get 0 multiplied with 2 plus 1. So 15 is basically, you got to the quotient zero. So 15 is these remainders in base two. So it's 1111. That gives you these mappings that basically you enumerate from zero to F, and each one of them is basically one number in of four digits in binary, okay? So this goes up to E in hexadecimal, which is basically 1110 in binary. Okay. So basically there is a mapping that you don't need to remember it, but you know, you need to know how you get it. Basically, if you get A and you want to transform it in binary, you basically have to transform it first. And this is just a mapping that you need to remember. From hexadecimal to decimal, A represents 10, B represents 11. All of the others are just directly translated up to A. Then you take that number and you translate it to a binary by dividing with 2 until you get the quotient 0. And it gives you 4 digits for every hexadecimal number. Okay.
Professor, I have a question. Yeah. So do we have to memorize the conversion from hex to decimal?
From hex to decimal, yes. You need to remember that up to 9 is just directly the number. You need to memorize that A corresponds to 10, B to 11, C to 12, D to 13, and so on. But if you know the alphabet, you basically know that A represents 10, and then you can find for whatever letter what does it represent. Because you say A is 10, B is 11, C is 12, D is 13, E is 14. So you don't need to remember the fact that E is 14. You can find it out as long as you know that A is 10.
Okay. And you thank you. Okay, thank you.
Next is the inverse conversion. Given a binary number, the translation to hexadecimal is done by grouping the binary digits four at a time, starting from the right-hand side. So if you get a number in binary, like 11100101101, you group four at a time the digits and you apply the same conversion. So basically 1101 is 8 plus 4, 12 plus 13 corresponds to D. You either remember that 1101 corresponds to D, or you actually do the calculation and you see that this binary number for these four digits is 13 and 13 is D. Similarly, like the next 1100 is 8. So that's actually its own digit in hexadecimal. The last, the leftmost 11 can be preceded by zeros. So again, putting zeros in front of a number doesn't change the number. So it's really this 11 is 2 plus 1, which is 3. So this is how you do any translation from binary to hexadecimal. So no matter who gives you some sequence of ones and zeros, doesn't matter really how many they are, and this is in binary and asks you, how do you convert this in hexadecimal? All that you need to do is to start grouping them. So these are four, these are four, these are four, these are four, and this is just a one. Okay, good. So now we go at the end. One translates into one. Next one is 4 plus 1, which is 5. Next group is 4 plus 2, which is 6. Next group is 1010, which is 8 plus 2, which is 10, which corresponds to A. So this number is 156A in hexadecimal, because all that I did, I grouped four at a time, starting from the right-hand side up to the, when I run out of digits, and then I group, I convert every group to the corresponding hexadecimal number. So this is 1, this is 5, this is 6, this is 6, I forgot 16. And this is 10. By the way, the same algorithm can be applied for octal. So again, if somebody gives you this number and says convert it to octal, instead of grouping four digits at a time, you group three digits at a time. So three digits from the right-hand side. So three digits, three digits, three digits, three digits, three digits. Okay, so now first group is just two. Next group is 4 plus 1, which is 5. Next group is 2 plus 1, which is 3. Next group is just 1. Next group is 4 plus 1, which is 5. And the last group is 2. So that long number in binary is 253152 in octal.
Professor, so to do that, when you are saying the numbers, are you just taking the 0 times the 8 to the power of 0 and then 8 to the power of 1?
So yes, exactly. So this number, when you want to convert it to decimal, in the, let's say that next is to convert it to decimal, you need to look at the positions. So this will be 2 times 8 to the power 0 plus 5 multiplied with 8 to the power 1 plus 1 multiplied with 8 to the power 2 plus 3 multiplied with 8 to the power 4 plus 5 multiplied with 8 to the power 5 plus 2 multiplied with 8 to the power 6. Basically, that's a different conversion. How do you convert from octal to decimal?
Okay, so then to get these numbers, how did you do that then?
Again, the binary number, I grouped three digits at a time, starting from the right-hand side. Okay. So I took that long binary number and I took three digits at a time and I built groups.
Yeah, but how did you know like 101 is A, is my question.
How do I know that which one?
1010 this one. Is A.
It's 5.
The top line. Okay, yeah. Well, that too. Okay. How did you know?
101 is also 5 here. Oh, the last one. 1010 is A.
Yeah, how did you know that?
Okay. So basically, I convert these 4 digits into decimal.
Okay.
And in decimal is 1 multiplied with 2 to the power 3 plus 0 plus 1 multiplied with 2 to the power 2. And this is 10. And 10
okay.
In the decimal is A.
Okay, okay. I see. Okay, thank you.
And similarly for other ones, like for instance, in any one of these, I basically just applied the same algorithm that I translated to decimal. And that decimal will tell me what is in hexadecimal. So that's why I put here in this column, the third column, also the decimal, because basically usually from binary, I convert to decimal and then I know what that corresponds to hexadecimal.
Okay, thank you.
Welcome. Okay. One question in the chat is how do we convert from hexadecimal to octal? I mean, personally, I would go through binary because that's the easiest. So you take the hexadecimal, you convert every digit to the corresponding binary, again, using the same mapping that we saw in that slide, in the previous slide. Then you convert from the binary to octal. That's the easiest, okay, because you go through another base and then you come to octal in 2 steps.
So basically you're saying hexa to binary?
Binary to octal.
No, hexa to decimal to binary.
Yes, that's another way if you want.
Oh, okay.
That's an easy algorithm because you transform the hex into decimal and the decimal into binary by doing divisions. Yeah, but the question in the chat how was how to convert from hex to octal.
So hex to decimal to octal.
That's actually, that's another way. Yeah, but the way that I proposed was hex to binary to octal. It's easier for me to do basically this translation through a mapping instead of doing divisions and multiplications with 16 powers of 16 and divisions by 8. I mean, you can do it, but I personally find it easier to just use this mapping and remember the mapping. But
yeah, it's more basic.
Both algorithms are good. Don't get me wrong. Both algorithms are good.
Oh, Professor, okay. I had a quick question.
Go ahead.
It was about the previous slide, line 5, where you were explaining to another student about how it's from binary to decimal.
Mm-hmm.
I just didn't know how you. I know why one. I know that 1010 is equal to A, but I didn't listen to your explanation carefully. I kind of skimmed over that. Is it okay if you explain it real quick again?
It's right here.
Yeah.
So first you convert it to decimal. So 1010 is 1 multiplied with 2 to the power 3 plus 0 multiplied with 2 to the power 2 plus 1 multiplied with 2 plus 0 multiplied with 2 to the power 0, which is 8 plus 2, because those are the only powers for which the bit is 1, which is 10. And 10 is A in hexadecimal.
Okay.
And the same you can do for anything else. Like for instance, I give you 1110 and I say, what is this in hexadecimal? Usually you go through decimal. So it's 8 plus 4 plus 2, which is equal with 14. And 14 is equal with E. Basically you remember that these letters from A to F are corresponding to one of the letters, like A is 10, 14 in this case is basically E.
Thank you.
No problem. So now decimal, hexadecimal to decimal. And again, you have a hexadecimal, a sequence of digits, but in hexadecimal digits, and you want to transform them to decimal. So 7F in hex is 7 multiplied with 16 to the power 1 plus 15. That's the corresponding from F multiplied with 16 to the power 0. So again, the same idea that you take the hexadecimal. So let's say same number, 7F. 7F is in hexadecimal. You first index every one of these. So basically, start from the right-hand side and give it an index of 0. And then increment with 1 and move to the left hand side. So now this will be 7, the digit that we have there, multiply with the base, in our case is 16, to the power of the position, the power 1, plus f is 15, multiplied with 16 to the power 0. Anything to the power 0 is 1. So really, this is 7 multiplied with 16 plus 15. And I believe this is 127. Okay. So this is the conversion from hex, hexadecimal to decimal. Decimal to hexadecimal is by division. So the same way that we did it for basically binary, instead of dividing by 2, we divide by 16. So 123 in hexadecimal, we divide 123 with 16, we get the quotient 7 and the remainder 11. We continue with the quotient, 7 divided by 16 gives us the quotient 0 and the remainder 7. And then we read the remainders in opposite order as we got them. So 7b, because 11 corresponds to b. So the number 123 in decimal is 7b in hexadecimal. Okay. Similar for octal, instead of dividing by 16, you divide by 8. And that's how you get decimal to octal. Now, again, this is just what I was showing you here. If you want to convert from binary to octal, you group the digits 3 at a time. First of all, from octal to binary, you just take the digit and you see what is the corresponding decimal. And from that decimal, what's the corresponding binary? So let's take, for instance, 4. 4 is the decimal 4, and 4 in binary is 100. It's basically 2 to the power 2 plus 0 plus 0. So you have to kind of remember this. You're right that basically you need to remember basic 3-digit or 4-digit binary numbers. After you actually do them for, like, let's say 50 times, you will remember them. To me, they come natural because I'm doing this for quite a while. You show me a binary number with 4 or 3 digits, and I will tell you immediately what's the octal or what's the hexadecimal for it. And similarly, if you want to convert a binary to octal, you start grouping the digits, the bits, 3 at a time from the right-hand side. So 101 is 5, 001 is 1, 110 is 4 plus 2, which is 6, and 1 is just 1. So this binary number is 1615 in octal. When you don't want to do it in your head, you can use the Windows calculator. So just to show you, the calculator has multiple modes. The programmer mode is the one that shows you the basis. So for instance, let's say that we are in decimal and we want 15. So it already tells us that 15 in hexadecimal is F, octal is 17, binary is 1111. So you can also change between the bases and basically write the number in binary. So let's say 1010 is the hexadecimal A, decimal 10, octal 12. Okay. Any questions up to now? we are kind of winding towards the end. So I will actually stop here and we'll continue with the next part next time. So I will tell you about the memory, how characters are stored in memory, and tell you about ASCII and Unicode, and then we'll talk about programming languages. So let's stop here today and take any other questions that you may have, and then I will stop the recording and post it on Piazza. Any questions?
Professor, will we be tested on these conversions? Is it good to know it? Okay.
Why we learn them. And the reason is that we actually use them quite often. So I can tell you, you will use them at least in 5-10 problems by the time of the midterm.
So it's good to not rely on the calculator then.
Of course not, because you can't use it during an exam.
Of course. Okay, thank you.
Welcome. Other questions? If not, thank you very much. I will stop the recording and go ahead.
Oh, no, I was just saying thank you.
Oh, thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor.